is going to be a live reading. This is the resignation letter of Jogindranath Mandal. Now, Jogindranath Mandal was a Dalit leader who, after being Subhash Chandra Bose, was expelled from Indian National Congress in 1940, he became active with Muslim League, which was the only other significant national party. He became a minister in the cabinet of Hussain Shaheed Sohrawardi. He was the then chief minister of the state of Bengal, the state which played a significant role in the Tehreek-e-Pakistan, or the founding of Pakistan. Mandal was the follower of Dr. Baba Sahib Ambedkar, the father of Indian Constitution. And it was also around this time that Mandal and B.R. Ambedkar established the Bengal branch of Scheduled Caste Federation, which itself aspired to political power. So he saw a distinction between the communal affairs and political disputes involving Indian National Congress and Muslim League. When riots broke out in 1946, the riots, by the way, were conducted and perpetrated by Muslim League. It is called Direct Action Day. Please read about it. He traveled around East Bengal to urge Dalit people not to participate in violence against Muslims. He argued that Dalits were being used as pawns by caste Hindus in their dispute with Muslim League. Okay. And when Muslim League joined the interim government of India in October 1946, Jinnah nominated Mandal as one of the League's five representatives. So he is among the first parliamentarians, the first senators, first founding fathers of Pakistan. And King George VI duly appointed Mandal to the body, where he took over the law portfolio. So he was among the founding members of the Constituent Assembly of Pakistan in 1947. At their inaugural session, he was also appointed their temporary chairman. He agreed as the new state's first minister of law and labor, becoming the highest ranking Hindu member of the government. And from 1947 till 1950, he lived in the port city of Karachi, which was the then capital of Pakistan. However, all the promises fell hollow. In 1950, Mandal came back to India after submitting his resignation to Liaquat Ali Khan, the then Prime Minister of Pakistan. Citing the blatant anti-Hindu bias of the Pakistani administration. He mentioned incidents related to social injustice and biased attitude towards non-Muslim minorities in his resignation letter. So he actually came back to India. He died on 5 October 1968 in his home state of West Bengal after living an anonymous life after his return from Pakistan. So the promised utopia never delivered and has failed to deliver after 7 decades. But there will be another video on that, maybe anytime next time. However, right now, this is a live reading of Jogindranath Mandal's resignation letter. Now, this is a very long letter, so I don't know if I have the vocal cords left to read such a long letter, but I will try and complete this in one video, and let's see how it goes. And this, I feel, Indian government should make mandatory in all our history books, because this is an important, and every Pakistani must ask themselves about this. So it begins. My dear Prime Minister, with a heavy heart and a sense of utter frustration at the failure of my lifelong mission to uplift the backward Hindu masses of East Bengal, that I feel compelled to tender resignation of my membership of your cabinet. It is proper that I should set forth in detail the reasons which have prompted me to take this decision at this important juncture of the Indo-Pakistani subcontinent. It is to share just a truth. Before I narrate the remote and immediate cause of my resignation, it may be useful to give a short background of the most important events that taken place during the period of my cooperation with the League. Having been approached by a few prominent League leaders of Bengal in February 1943, I agreed to work with them in the Bengal Legislative Assembly. After the fall of the Fazlul Haq Ministry in March 1943, with a party of 21 scheduled caste MLAs, I agreed to cooperate with Khwaja Nazimuddin, the then leader of the Muslim League Parliamentary Party, who formed the cabinet in April 1943. Our cooperation was conditional on certain specific terms, such as inclusion of three scheduled caste ministers in the cabinet, sanctioning of a sum of rupees 5 lakhs as annual recurring grant for the education of the scheduled castes, and the unqualified application of the communal ratio rules in the matter of appointment to government services. Apart from these terms, the principal objectives that prompted me to work in cooperation with the Muslim League was, first, that the economic interests of the Muslims in Bengal were generally identical with those of the scheduled castes. Muslims were mostly cultivators and laborers, and so were the members of the scheduled caste. One section of Muslims were fishermen, so were the section of scheduled caste as well. And secondly, that the scheduled castes and the Muslims are both educationally backward. I was persuaded that my cooperation with the League and its ministry would lead to the undertaking on a wide scale of legislative and administrative measure, which, while promoting the mutual welfare of the vast bulk of Bengal's population and undermining the foundations of vested interest and privilege, would further the cause of communal peace and harmony. It may be mentioned that here that Khwaja Nazimuddin took three scheduled caste ministers in his cabinet and appointed three parliamentary secretaries from among the members of my community. Now under Suharwardi Ministry. After the general election held in March 1946, Mr. H.S. Suharwardi became the leader of the League Parliamentary Party in March 1946 and formed the League Ministry in April 1946. It was the only scheduled caste member returned on the Federation ticket. I was included in Mr. Suharwardi's cabinet. The 16th day of August of that year was observed in Calcutta as the Direct Action Day by Muslim League. It resulted, as you know, in a Holocaust. Hindus demanded my resignation from the League Ministry. My life was in peril. I began to receive threatening letter almost every day, but I remained steadfast in my policy. Moreover, I issued an appeal through our general Jagran to the scheduled caste people to keep themselves aloof from the bloody feud between the Congress and the Muslim League, even at the risk of my life. I cannot but greatly acknowledge the fact that I was saved from the wrath of infuriated Hindu mobs by my caste Hindu neighbors. The Calcutta carnage was followed by the Naukhali riots in October 1946. There, Hindus, including scheduled castes, were killed and hundreds were converted to Islam. Hindu women were raped and abducted. Members of my community also suffered loss of life and property. Immediately after these happenings, I visited Tipperah and Feni and saw some riot-affected areas. The terrible suffering of Hindus overwhelmed me with grief, but still I continued the policy of cooperation with the Muslim League. Immediately after the massive Calcutta killing, a no-confidence motion was moved against the Suharwardi Ministry. It was only due to my effort that the supports of the four Anglo-Indian members and four scheduled caste members of the assembly who had hitherto been with the Congress could be secured, but for which the ministry would have been defeated. In October 1946, most unexpectedly came to me through Mr. Sorvardi the offer of a seat in the interim Government of India. After a good deal of hesitation and being only given 1 hour's time to take my final decision, I consented to accept the offer, subjected to the condition only that I should be permitted to resign if my leader, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, disapproved of my action. Fortunately, however, I received his approval in a telegram sent from London. Before I left for Delhi to take over as law minister, I'm sorry, before I left for Delhi to take over as law member, I persuaded Mr. Sorvardi, the then Chief Minister of Bengal, to agree to take two ministries in his cabinet in my place and to appoint two parliamentary secretaries from Scheduled Caste Federation Group. I joined the interim government on November 1st, 1946, after about a month when I paid a visit to Calcutta. Mr. Sorvardi apprised me of the communal tension in some parts of East Bengal, especially in Gopalganj subdivision, where the Namashudras were in majority, being very high. He requested me to visit those areas and address meeting of Muslims and Namashudras. The fact was that Namashudras in those areas had made presentation for retaliation. I addressed about a dozen of largely attended meetings. The result was that Namashudras give up the idea of retaliation. Thus, an inevitable dangerous communal disturbance was averted. After a few months, the British government made their June 3rd statement, 1947, embodying certain proposals for the partition of India. The whole country, especially the entire non-Muslim India, was startled. For the sake of truth, I must admit that I always considered the demand of Pakistan by Muslim League as a bargaining counter, although I honestly felt that in context of India as a whole, Muslims had legitimate cause for grievance against upper caste Hindu chauvinism. I held the view very strongly indeed that the creation of Pakistan would never solve the communal problem. On the contrary, it would aggravate communal hatred and bitterness. Besides, I maintained that it would not ameliorate the condition of Muslims in Pakistan. The inevitable result of the partition of the country would be prolonged, if not perpetuate, the poverty, illiteracy, and miserable condition of the toiling masses of both the states. I further apprehended that Pakistan must turn to be one of the most backward and underdeveloped countries of Southeast Asia. Then Lahore Resolution. I must make it clear that I have thought that an attempt would be made, as is being done at present, to develop Pakistan as purely Islamic state based on the Shariat and injection and formulae of Islam. I presume that it would be set up in all essential and pattern contemplated in the Muslim League resolution adopted at Lahore on March 23, 1940. That resolution stated that inter alia, the geographically contiguous areas that are demarcated into regions which should be constituted with such territorial readjustment as may be necessary, that the areas in which the Muslims are numerically in majority, as in the northwestern and eastern zones of India, should be grouped to constitute independent states in which the constituent units shall be autonomous and sovereign. Adequate, effective, and mandatory safeguards should be specifically provided in the constitution for minorities in these units and in these regions for the protection of their religious, cultural, political, administrative, and other rights and interest in consultation with them. Implicity in this formula were A, that northwestern and eastern Muslim zones should be constituted into two independent states, and B, that the constituent units of these states should be autonomous and sovereign. C, that minorities' guarantee should be in respect of rights as well as interest and extend to every sphere of their lives. And D, that constitutional provisions should be made in these regards in consultation with minorities themselves. I was fortified in my faith in this resolution and the profession of the League leadership by the statement Qaid-e-Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah was pleased to make on the 11th August 1947 as the President of the Constituent Assembly, giving solemn assurance of equal treatment of Hindus and Muslims alike, calling upon them to remember that they were all Pakistanis. There was then no question of dividing the people on the basis of religion into full-fledged Muslim citizens and Zimmis or Dhimmis, being under the perpetual custody of the Islamic State and its Muslim citizens. Every one of these pledges is being flagrantly violated, apparently to your knowledge and with your approval, in complete disregard of Qaid-e-Azam's wishes and sentiments, and to the detriment and humiliation of the minorities. Partition of Bengal. It may also be mentioned in this connection that I was opposed to the partition of Bengal. In launching a campaign in this regard, I had to face not only tremendous resistance from all quarters, but also unspeakable abuse, insult, and dishonor. With great regret, I recollect those days when 32 crores of Hindus of this Indo-Pakistan subcontinent turned their backs against me and dubbed me as the enemy of Hindus and Hinduism, but I remain undaunted and unmoved in my loyalty to Pakistan. It is a matter of gratitude that my appeal to 7 million scheduled caste people of Pakistan evoked a ready and enthusiastic response from them. They lend me their unstinted support, sympathy, and encouragement. After the establishment of Pakistan on August 14, 1947, you formed the Pakistan cabinet, in which I was included, and Khwaja Nazimuddin formed a provisional cabinet for East Bengal. On August 10th, I had spoken to Khwaja Nazimuddin at Karachi and requested him to take two scheduled caste ministers in the East Bengal cabinet. He promised to do the same sometime later. What happened subsequently in this regard was a record of unpleasant and disappointing negotiations with you, Khwaja Nazimuddin, and Mr. Nurul Amin, the present Chief Minister of East Bengal. When I realized that Khwaja Nazimuddin was avoiding the issue on this, or that, I'm sorry, When I realized that Khwaja Nizamuddin was avoiding this issue on this or that excuse, I became utmost impatient and exasperated. I further discussed the matter with the president of the Pakistan Muslim League and the East Bengal branch. Ultimately, I brought the matter to your notice. You were pleased to discuss the subject with Khwaja Nizamuddin in my presence at your residence. Khwaja Nizamuddin agreed to take one scheduled caste minister on his return to Dhaka. As I already became skeptical about the assurance of Khwaja Nizamuddin, I wanted to be definite about the time frame. I insisted that he must act in this regard with a month, failing which I would be at liberty to resign. Both you and Khwaja Nizamuddin agreed to the condition, but alas, you did not perhaps mean what you said. Khwaja Nizamuddin did not keep his promise. After Mr. Nurul Amin became the Chief Minister of East Bengal, I again took up the matter with him. He also followed the same old familiar tactics of evasion. When I again called your attention to this matter prior to your visit to Dhaka in 1949, you were pleased to assure me that minority ministers would be appointed in East Bengal being East Pakistan. And you asked two-third names from me for consideration. In stat defense to your wish, I sent you a note stating the Federation group in East Bengal Assembly and suggested three names. When I made inquiries as to what happened on your return to Dhaka, you appeared to be very cold and only remarked, "Let Nurul Amin return from Delhi." After a few days, I again pressed on the matter, but you avoided the issue. I was then forced to come to the conclusion that neither you nor Mr. Nurul Amin had any intention to take any scheduled caste minister in East Bengal cabinet. Apart from this, I was noticing that Mr. Nurul Amin and some league leaders of East Bengal were trying to create disruption among the members of the Scheduled Caste Federation. It appeared to me that my leadership and widespread popularity were considered ominous. My outspokenness, vigilance, and sincere efforts to safeguard the interest of the minorities in Pakistan in general and of the scheduled caste in particular were considered a matter of annoyance to the East Bengal government and few league leaders. Undaunted, I took my firm stand to safeguard the interest of the minorities of Pakistan. Anti-Hindu policy. When the question of partition of Bengal arose, the scheduled caste people were alarmed at the anticipated dangerous result of partition. Representation on their behalf were made to Mr. Sohrawardi, the then Chief Minister of Bengal, who was pleased to issue a statement to the press declaring that none of the rights and privileges hitherto employed by the scheduled caste people would be curtailed after partition, and that they would not only continue to enjoy the existing rights and privileges, but also receive additional advantages. Their assurance was given by Mr. Sohrawardi not only in his personal capacity, but also in his capacity as the Chief Minister of League Ministry. To my utter regret, it is to be stated that after partition, particularly after the death of Qaid-e-Azam, the scheduled caste have not received a fair deal in any matter. You will recollect that from time to time I brought the grievances of the scheduled caste to your notice. I explained to you on several occasions the nature of inefficient administration in East Bengal. I made serious charges against the police administration. I brought to your notice the incidents of barbarous atrocities perpetrated by the police on frivolous grounds. I did not hesitate to bring to your notice anti-Hindu policy pursued by East Bengal government, especially the police administration and section of Muslim League leaders. The first incident that shocked me took place at a village called Digarkul near Gopalganj, where on false complaint of a Muslim, brutal atrocities were committed to the local Namashudras. The fact that a Muslim who was going in a boat attempted to throw his net to catch fish, a Namashudra who was already there for the same purpose, opposed the throwing of the net in his front. This was followed by some altercation, and the Muslim got annoyed, went to the nearby Muslim village, and made a false complaint that he and a woman in his boat have been assaulted by the Namashudras. At this time, the STO of Gopalganj was passing in a boat through the canal, who, without making any inquiries, accepted the complaint as true and sent armed police to the spot to punish the Namashudras. The armed police came, and local Muslims also joined them. They not only raided some houses of the Namashudras, but mercilessly beat both men and women, destroyed their properties, and took away valuables. The merciless beating of a pregnant woman resulted in abortion on the spot. This brutal action on the part of the local authority created panic over a large area. The second incidents of police oppression took place in the early part of 1949 under P.S. Gornadi in the district of Barisal. Here, a quarrel took place between two groups of members of a union board. One group, which was in the good books of the police, conspired against the opponents on the plea of their being communists. On the information of a threat of attack on the police station, the OC Gornadi requisitioned armed forces from the headquarters. The police, helped by the armed forces, then raided a large number of houses in the area, took away valuable properties, even from the house of absentee owners who were never in politics, far less in the Communist Party. A large number of persons over a wide area were arrested. Teachers and students of many high English schools were communist suspects and unnecessarily harassed. This area being very near to my native village, I was informed of the incident. I wrote to the district magistrate and the SP for an inquiry. A section of the local people also prayed for an inquiry by the SDO, but no inquiries were held. Even my letter to the district authorities were not acknowledged. I then brought this matter to the notice of the highest authority in Pakistan, including yourself, but to no avail. Women for military. The atrocities perpetrated by the police and the military on the innocent Hindus, especially the scheduled caste in Habibgarh, caste of Habibgarh in the district of Silhet, deserves description. Innocent men and women were brutally tortured, some women ravished, their houses raided, properties looted by the police and the local Muslims. Military pickets were posted in the area. The military not only oppressed these people and took away stuff forcibly from Hindus' houses, but also forced Hindus to send their women folk at the night to the camp to satisfy the carnal desires of the military. This fact also I brought to your notice. You assured me of a good report on the matter, but unfortunately no report was forthcoming. Then occurred the incident at the Nashol in the district of Rajshahi, where the name of the suppressor of communists not only name of okay then occurred the incident at the Nashol in the district of Rajshahi, where in the name of suppression of communists, not only the police but also local Muslims in collaboration with the police oppressed the Hindus and looted their properties. The Santals then crossed the border and came over to Bengal. They narrated the stories of atrocities wantonly committed by the Muslims and the police. An instance of callous and cold-blooded brutality is furnished by the incident that took place in December 20, 1949 in Kalshera under P.S. Molarhat in the district of Khulna. What happened was that late at night, four constables raided the house of one Joydev Brahma in village Kalshira in search of some alleged communists. At the scent of the police, half a dozen young men, some of whom might have been communists, escaped from the house. The police constable entered into the house and assaulted the wife of Joydev Brahma, whose cry attracted her husband and a few companions who escaped from the house. They became desperate, re-entered the house, found four constables with one gun only. This perhaps might have encouraged the young men, who struck a blow on one armed constable who died on the spot. The young men then attacked another constable when the other two ran away and raised alarm, which attracted some neighboring peoples who came to their rescue. As the incident took place before sunrise, when it was dark, the assailants fled with the dead body before the villagers could come. The SP of Khulna with the contingent of military and armed police appeared on the scene in the afternoon of the following day. In the meantime, the assailants fled and the intelligent neighbors also fled away. But the bulk of villagers remained in their houses and they were absolutely innocent and failed to realize the consequence of the happening. Subsequently, the SP, the military and armed police began to beat mercilessly the innocents of the entire village, encouraged the neighboring Muslims to take away their properties. A number of persons were killed and men and women were forcibly converted. Household deities were broken, the places of worship desecrated and destroyed. Several women were raped by the police, military and local Muslims. Thus, a veritable hell was let loose not only in the village of Kalshira, which is 1.5 miles in length with a large population, but also a number of neighboring Namashudra villages. The village Kalshira was never suspected by the authority to be a place of communist activities. Another village called Jalhardanga, which was at a distance of 3 miles from Kalshira, was known to be a center of communist activities. This village was raided by a large contingent of the police on that day for hunt of alleged communists, a number of whom fled away and took shelter in the aforesaid house of the village Kalshira, which was considered to be a safe place for them. I visited Kalshira and one of the two neighboring villages on February 28, 1950. The SP Khulna and some of the prominent league leaders of the district were with me. When I came to the village Kalshira, I found the place desolate and in ruins. I was told in the presence of SP that there were 350 homesteads in this village. Of these, only three had been spared and the rest has been demolished. Country boats and heads of cattle belonging to Namashudra have all been taken away. I reported these facts to Chief Minister, Chief Secretary, and Inspector of General of Police of East Bengal and to you. It may be mentioned in this connection that the news of this incident was published in West Bengal press. This created some unrest among the Hindus there. A number of sufferers from Kalshera, both men and women, homeless and destitute, had also come to Calcutta, narrated the stories of their sufferings, which resulted in some communal disturbances in West Bengal in the last part of January. Causes of the February disturbance. It must be noted that stories of a few incidents in communal disturbances that took place in West Bengal as a sort of repercussion to the incidents at Kalshera were published in exaggerated form in the East Bengal press. In the second week of February 1950, when the budget session of the East Bengal Assembly commenced, the Congress members sought permission to move two adjournment motions to discuss the situation created at Kalshera and Nashol. But the motions were disallowed. The Congress members walked out of the assembly in protest. This action of the Hindu members of the assembly annoyed and enraged not only the ministers but also the Muslim leaders and the officials of the province. This was perhaps one of the principal reasons for Dhaka and East Bengal riots in February 1950. This is significant that on February 10, 1950, at about 10 o'clock in the morning, a woman was painted with red to show that her breast was cut off in Calcutta riot and was taken round the East Bengal Secretariat at Dhaka. Immediately, the government servants of the Secretariat stuck work and came out in procession raising slogans of revenge against Hindus. This procession began to swell as it passed over a distance of more than a mile. It ended in a meeting at Victoria Park at about 12 o'clock and in the noon, where violent speeches against Hindus were delivered by several speakers, including officials. The fun of the whole show was that while the employee of the Secretariat went out of procession, the Chief Secretary of East Bengal was holding a conference with his West Bengal counterpart in the same building to find out means to stop communal disturbances in the two Bengals. Officials helped looters. The riot started at about 1 p.m. simultaneously all over the city. Arson, looting of Hindu shops and houses, and killing of Hindus wherever they were found commenced in full swing in all parts of the city. I got evidence even from the Muslims that arson and looting were committed even in the presence of high police officials. Jewelry shops belonging to the Hindus were looted in the presence of police officers. They not only did not attempt to stop the loot, but also helped the looters with devices and direction. Unfortunately for me, I reached Dhaka at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on the same day, and in February 10, 1950. To my utter dismay, I had occasion to see and know things from close quarters. What I saw and learned from the first-hand information was simply staggering and heartrending. Background of the riot. The reason for the Dhaka riot were mainly five. To punish the Hindus for the daring action of their representatives in the assembly in their expression of protest by walking out of the assembly when two adjournment motions of Kalshera and Nashol affairs were disallowed. Dissension and differences between the Swarwardi group and the Nazimuddin group in Parliament party were becoming acute. Apprehension of launching a movement for reunion of East and West Bengal by both Hindu and Muslim leaders made the East Bengal ministry and the Muslim League nervous. They wanted to prevent such a move. They thought that any large-scale communal riot in East Bengal were sure to produce reactions in West Bengal where Muslims might be killed. The result of such riots in both East and West Bengal, it was believed, would prevent any movement of reunion for Bengal. Feeling of antagonism between Bengali Muslims and non-Bengali Muslims in East Bengal was gaining ground. This could only be prevented by creating hatred between Hindus and Muslims of East Bengal. The language question was also connected with it. Wow, all the seeds of Bangladesh. Day one. The consequences of non-devaluation and the Indo-Pakistan trade deadlock to the economy of East Bengal were being felt most acutely, first in urban and rural areas, and the Muslim League members and officials wanted to divert the attention of the Muslim masses from the impending economic breakdown by some sort of jihad against Hindus. They still do that. Staggering detail, nearly 10,000 killed. During my 9-day stay at Dhaka, I visited most of the riot-affected area of the city and suburbs. I visited Mirpur, also under P.S. Tejgaon. The news of the killing of hundreds of innocent Hindus in trains on railway lines between Dhaka and Narayanganj and Dhaka and Chittagong gave me the rudest shock. On the second day of Dhaka riot, I met Chief Minister of East Bengal and requested him to issue immediate instructions to the district authorities to take all precautionary measures to prevent spreading of the riot in district towns and rural areas. On February 20, 1950, I reached Barisal town, and was astounded to know that the happenings in Barisal, in the district town, a number of Hindu houses were burned and a large number of Hindus killed. I visited almost all riot-affected areas in the district. I was simply puzzled to find the havoc wrought by the Muslim rioters. Even at places like Kashipur and Madhapasha and Lakutia, which were within a radius of 6 miles from the district town and were connected with motorable roads. At the Madhapasha Zamindar's house, about 200 people were killed and 40 injured. A place called Muladi witnessed a dreadful hell. At Muladi Bandar alone, the number of killed would total more than 300, as was reported by the local Muslims, including some officers. I visited Muladi villages also, where I found skeletons of dead bodies at some places. I found dogs and vultures eating corpses on the riverside. I got the information from there that the whole-scale killing of adult males, all the young girls were distributed among the ringleaders of the miscreants. At a place called Kaibarthkali, under the PS Rajapur, PS being police station, 63 people were killed. Hindu houses within a stone throw distance from the said Thana office were looted, burnt, and inmates killed. All Hindu shops of Babu Ganj Bazaar were looted and burnt, and a large number of Hindus were killed. From detailed information received, a conservative estimate of casualties was placed at 2,500 killed in the district of Barisal alone. Total casualties of Dhaka and East Bengal riot was estimated to be in the neighborhood of 10,000 killed. The lamentation of women and children who had lost their all, including near and dear ones, melted my heart. I only asked myself what was coming to Pakistan in the name of Islam. Wow. It was all written. No earnest desire to implement Delhi Pact. The large-scale exodus of Hindus from Bengal commenced from the latter part of March. It appeared that within a short time, all the Hindus would migrate to India. A cry was raised in India. The situation became extremely critical. A national calamity appeared to be inevitable. The apprehended disaster, however, was avoided by the Delhi Agreement on April 8th. With a view to reviving already lost morale of the panicky Hindu, I undertook our extensive tour of East Bengal. I visited a number of places in the district of Dhaka, Barisal, Faridpur, Khulna, and Jessore. I addressed dozens of largely attended meetings and asked the Hindus to take courage and not leave their ancestral hearths and homes. I had this expectation that the East Bengal government and Muslim League leaders would implement the terms of the Delhi Agreement, but with the lapse of time, I began to realize that neither the East Bengal government nor the Muslim League leaders were really earnest in the matter of implementation of the Delhi Agreement. The East Bengal government was not only ready to set up a machinery as envisaged in the Delhi Agreement, but also not willing to take effective steps for the purpose. A number of Hindus who returned to native village immediately after the Delhi Agreement were not given possession of their homes and lands, which were occupied by, in the meantime, by Muslims. Maulana Akram Khan's incitations. My suspicion about the intention of League leaders was confirmed when I read editorial comments by Maulana Akram Khan, the president of Provincial Muslim League in Baisakh, issue of a monthly journal called Mohammadi. In commenting on the first radio broadcast, Dr. A.M. Malik, Minister of Minority Affairs of Pakistan, from Dhaka radio station, wherein they said, even Prophet Muhammad had given religious freedom to the Jews in Arabia. Maulana Akram Khan said, Dr. Malik would have done well had he not made any reference to his speech to the Jews of Arabia. It is true that the Jews of Arabia had been given religious freedom by Prophet Muhammad, but it was the first chapter of the history. The last chapter contained the definite direction of Prophet Muhammad, which runs as follows. Drive away all the Jews out of Arabia. Let's cry Islamophobia now. Even despite the editorial comment of a person who held a very high position in the political, social, and spiritual life of the Muslim community, I entertained some expectation that the Nurul Amin ministry might not be so insincere. But that expectation of mine was totally shattered when Nurul Amin selected D.N. Barari as minister to represent minorities in terms of the Delhi Agreement, which clearly states to restore confidence in the minds of minorities, one of their representatives will be taken in the Ministry of East Bengal and West Bengal government. Nurul Amin government's insincerity. In one of my public statements, I expressed to view that the appointment of D.N. Barari as minister representing the minorities not only did not help restore any confidence, but on the contrary, destroyed all expectations and illusion of expectations. If there was any in the minds of minorities about the sincerity of Mr. Nurul Amin's government, my own reaction was that Nurul Amin governments were not only insincere, but also wanted to dispute the principal objectives of the Delhi Agreement. I again repeat that D.N. Barari does not represent anyone, anybody except himself. He was returned to the Bengal Legislature Assembly on the Congress ticket with the money and organization of the Congress. He opposed the Scheduled Caste Federation candidates. Sometimes after his election, he betrayed the Congress and joined the Federation. When he was appointed a minister, he had ceased to be the member of the Federation too. I know that East Bengal Hindus agree with me that by antecedents, character and intellectual attainments, Bharati is not qualified to hold the position of a minister as envisaged in the Delhi Agreement. He was the Sheikh Rashid of his time. I recommended three names to Mr. Nurul Amin for this office. One of the persons I recommended was an MALLB advocate Dhaka High Court. He was minister for more than 4 years in the first Fazlul Haq ministry in Bengal. He was chairman of the Coal Mine Storing Board, Calcutta for about 6 years. He was the senior vice president of Scheduled Caste Federation. My second nominee was a BALLB. He was a member of Legislative Council for 7 years in the pre-reform regime. I would like to know what earthly reasons that might be for Mr. Nurul Amin if in not selecting any of these two gentlemen and appointing instead a person who's appointed as minister, I strongly objected to for very rightly considerations. Without any fear of contradiction, I can say that this action of Mr. Nurul Amin in selecting Bharati as a minister in terms of the Delhi Agreement is a conclusive proof that East Bengal government was neither serious nor sincere in professions about the terms of the Delhi Agreement, whose main purpose is to create such conditions that would enable Hindus to continue to live in East Bengal with a sense of security to their life, property, honor, and religion. The government planned to squeeze out Hindus. I would like to reiterate in this connection my firm conviction that East Bengal government is still following the well-planned policy of squeezing Hindus out of the province. In my discussion with you on more than one occasion, I gave expression to this view of mine. I must say that this policy of driving out Hindus from Pakistan has succeeded completely in West Pakistan and in nearing completion in East Pakistan too. The appointment of D.N. Bharati as a minister and the East Bengal government's unceremonious objection to my recommendation in this regard is strictly confirmed to the name of what they call an Islamic State. Pakistan has not given the Hindus entire satisfaction and a full sense of security. Now they want to get rid of Hindu intelligentsia so that the political, economic and social life of Pakistan may not in any way be influenced by them. Evasive techniques to shelve joint electorate. I have failed to understand why the question of electorate has not been decided. It is now 3 years that the minority subcommittee has been appointed. It sat on three occasions. The questions having joint separate electorate came up for and consideration at a meeting of the committee held in December last, when all the representative of recognized minorities in Pakistan expressed their view in support of the joint electorate with the reservation of seats for backward minorities. We, on behalf of the scheduled castes, demanded joint electorate with reservation of seats for scheduled castes. This matter again came up for consideration at a meeting called in August last, but without any discussion whatsoever on this point, the meeting was adjourned sine die. It is not difficult to understand what the motive is behind this kind of evasive tactics in regards to a vital matter on the part of Pakistan's rulers. Dismal future for Hindus. Coming now to the present condition and the future of Hindus in East Bengal as a result of the Delhi Agreement, I should say that the present condition is not only unsatisfactory, but also absolutely hopeless, and that the future completely dark and dismal. Confidence of Hindus in East Bengal has not been restored in the least. The agreement is treated as mere scrap of paper alike by the East Bengal government and the Muslim League. That a pretty large number of Hindu migrants, mostly scheduled caste cultivators, are returning to East Bengal is no indication that the confidence has been restored. It only indicates that their stay and rehabilitation in the West Bengal or elsewhere in the Indian Union have not been possible. The suffering of refugee life are compelling them to go back to their homes. Besides, many of them are going back to bring movable articles and settle or dispose of immovable properties. There is no serious communal disturbance has recently taken place in East Bengal. It is not to be attributed to the Delhi Agreement. It could not simply continue even if there were no agreement or pact. It must be admitted that the Delhi Pact was not an end in itself. It was intended that such conditions would be created as might effectively help resolve so many disputes and conflicts existing between India and Pakistan. But during this period of 6 months after the agreement, no dispute or conflict has been resolved. On the contrary, communal propaganda and anti-India propaganda by Pakistan, both at home and abroad, are continuing in full swing. The observance of Kashmir Day by the Muslim League all over Pakistan is an eloquent proof of communal anti-India propaganda by Pakistan. The recent speech of the government of Punjab, governor of Punjab, saying that Pakistan needed a strong army for the security of Indian Muslims, has betrayed the real attitude of Pakistan towards India. It will only increase the tension between the two countries. What is happening in East Bengal today? What is today the condition of East Bengal? About 50 lakh of Hindus have left since the partition of the country. Apart from the East Bengal riot of last February, the reasons for such a large-scale exodus of Hindus are many. The boycott by the Muslims of Hindu lawyers, medical practitioners, shopkeepers, traders, and merchants have compelled Hindus to migrate to West Bengal in search of their means of livelihood. Wholesale requisition of Hindu houses, even without the following due process of law in many, and non-payment of any rent whatsoever to the owners, have compelled them to seek for Indian shelter. Payment of rent to Hindu landlords was stopped long before. Besides, the Ansars, against whom I receive complaint all over, are standing menace for the safety and security of Hindus. Inference in matters of education and methods adopted by the Education Authority for Islamization frightened the teaching staff of secondary schools and colleges out of their old familiar moorings. They have left East Bengal. As a result, most of the educational institutions have been closed. I have received information that sometimes ago the Educational Authority issued circular in secondary schools enjoining compulsory participation of teachers and students of all communities in recitation from the Holy Quran before the school work commenced. Another circular requires headmasters of school to name the different blocks of the premises after 12 distinguished Muslims, such as Jinnah, Iqbal, Liaquat Ali, Nazimuddin, etc. Only very recently, in an educational conference held at Dhaka, the president disclosed that out of the 1,500 high English schools in East Bengal, only 500 were working. Okay. Owing to the migration of medical practitioners, there is hardly any means of proper treatment of patients. Almost all the priests who used to worship at the household deities at Hindu houses have left. Important places of worship have been abandoned. The result is that the Hindus of East Bengal have got now hardly any means to follow religious pursuits and performance of social ceremonies like marriages, where the services of a priest are essential. Artisans who made images of gods and goddesses have also left. Hindu priests of the Union Board have been replaced by Hindu presidents of union boards have been replaced by Muslims by coercive measures, with the active help and connivance of the police and circle officers. Hindu headmasters and secretaries of schools have been replaced by Muslims. The life of the few Hindu government servants has been made extremely miserable, as many of them have either been superseded by junior Muslims or dismissed without sufficient or any cause. Only very recently, a Hindu public prosecutor of Chittagong was arbitrarily removed from service, as has been made clear in the statement made by Srijukta Nelly Sen Gupta, against whom at least no charge, change of anti-Muslim bias, prejudice of malice or malice can be labeled. Hindus virtually outlawed. The condition of thefts and dacoities, even with murder, is going on as before. Thana offices seldom record half of the complaints made by Hindus. That the abduction and rape of Hindu girls have been reduced to a certain extent is due only to the fact that there is no caste Hindu girl between age 12 and 30 living in East Bengal at present. Wow. Nothing has changed. Seriously. The few depressed class girls who live in rural areas with their parents are not even spared by Muslim gundas. I have received information about a number of incidents of rape of scheduled caste girls by Muslims. Full payment is seldom made by Muslim buyers for the price of jute and other agricultural commodities sold by Hindus in marketplaces. As a matter of fact, there is no operation of law, justice, or fair play in Pakistan, so far as Hindus are concerned. Forced conversion in West Pakistan. Leaving aside the question of East Pakistan, let me now refer to West Pakistan, especially Sindh. The West Punjab had, after partition, about a lakh of scheduled caste people. It may be noted that a large number of them were converted to Islam. Only 4 out of a dozen scheduled caste girls abducted by Muslims have yet been recovered, in spite of repeated petition from the authority. Name of those girls with names of their abductors were supplied to the government. The last reply recently given by officer in charge of recovery of abducted girl said that his function was to recover Hindu girls and Achutes, and Achutes were not Hindus. Oh, okay. Let me repeat that. He said that his function was to recover Hindu girls and Achutes, aka scheduled castes, were not Hindus. The condition of the small number of Hindus that are still living in Sindh and Karachi, the capital of Pakistan, is simply deplorable. I've got a list of 363 Hindu temples and Gurdwaras of Karachi and Sindh, which is by no means an exhaustive list, which are still in possession of Muslims. Some of the temples have been converted into cobbler shops, slaughterhouses, and hotels. None of the Hindus has got back possession of their landed properties, were taken away from them without any notice and distributed among refugees and local Muslims. I personally know about 200 to 300 Hindus were declared non-evacuees by the custodian a pretty long time ago. But up till now, properties have not been restored to any of them. Even the possession of Karachi Pinjrapol has not been restored to the trustees. I'll have to read about this. Although it was declared non-evacuee property some time ago, in Karachi I received petitions from many unfortunate fathers and husbands of abducted Hindu girls, mostly scheduled castes. It drew the attention of the second provincial government in this fact. There was little or no effect. To my extreme regret, I received information that a large number of scheduled castes who are still living in Sindh have been forcibly converted to Islam. Pakistan accursed for Hindu. Now, this being in brief of the overall picture of Pakistan as far as Hindus are concerned, I shall not be unjustified in stating that Hindus of Pakistan, of their all intent and purpose, have been rendered stateless in their own house. They have no other fault that they profess the Hindu religion. Declarations are being made by repeatedly made by Muslim leaders that Pakistan is and shall be an Islamic state. Islam is being offered as the sovereign remedy for all earthly evils. In the matchless dialectics of capitalism and socialism, you present the exhilarating democratic synthesis of Islamic equality and fraternity. In that, the grand setting of the Shariat, Muslims alone are rulers, while Hindus and other minorities are zimmis who are entitled to protection at price. And you know more than anybody else, Mr. Prime Minister, at what price is, what that price is. After anxious and prolonged struggle, I have come to the conclusion that Pakistan is no place for Hindus to live in, and that their future is darkened by the ominous shadow of conversion or liquidation. The bulk of the upper class Hindus and politically conscious scheduled castes have left East Bengal. Those Hindus who will continue to stay accursed in the Pakistan will, I'm afraid, by gradual stages and in a planned manner, will either be converted to Islam or completely exterminated. It is really amazing that a man of your education, culture, and experience should be an exponent of a doctrine fraught with so great danger to humanity and subversive of all principles of equality and good sense. I may tell you that fellow workers, I may tell you and your fellow workers that Hindus will allow themselves, whatever the treat or temptation, to be treated as zimmis in the land of their birth. Today they may, as indeed many of them already done, abandon their hearts and homes in sorrow, but in panic. Tomorrow they strive for their right place in the economy of life. Who knows what is in the womb of the future? When I am convinced that my continuance in office in Pakistan's central government is not of any help to Hindus, I should not, with a clear conscience, create the false impression in their minds of the Hindus of Pakistan and people abroad that Hindus can live with honor in the sense of security and in respect of their life, property, and religion. This is about Hindus. No civil liberty, even for Muslims. And what about the Muslims who are outside the charmed circle of the League rulers and their corrupt and inefficient bureaucracy? 3 years of independence, and he declared Muslim League as corrupt, elitist, and inefficient. There is hardly anything called civil liberty in Pakistan. Wow, they were always like this. Witness, for example, the fate of Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, with whom a more devout Muslim had not walked this earth for many years, and of his gallant patriotic brother, Dr. Khan Sahib. A large number of erstwhile League leaders of the Northwest and also of the Eastern Belt of Pakistan are in detention without trial. Mr. Swarworthy, to whom is due in a large measure the League's triumph in Bengal, is for practical purposes a Pakistani prisoner who has to move under permit and open his lip under order. Mr. Fazlul Haq, that dearly loved grand old man of Bengal, who was the author of the now famous Lahore Resolution, is ploughing his lonely furrow in the plenarics of the Dhaka High Court of Judicature. The so-called Islamic planning is as ruthless as it is complete. About the East Bengal Muslims generals, the less said the better. They were promised of autonomous and sovereign units of the independent state. What they have got instead? East Bengal has been transferred into a colony of the Western Belt of Pakistan, although it contained a population which is larger than that of all the units of Pakistan put together. It is a pale, ineffective adjutant of Karachi doing the latter's bidding and carrying out its orders. East Bengal Muslims, in their enthusiasm, wanted bread, And they have, by mysteriously working of the Islamic State, and the Shariat got stone instead from the arid deserts of Sindh and Punjab. My own sad and bitter experience. Leaving aside the overall picture of Pakistan and the callous and cruel injustice done to others, my own personal experience is no less sad, bitter, and revealing. You used your position as Prime Minister and leader of the parliamentary party to ask me to issue a statement, which I did on the 8th September last. You know that I was not willing to make a statement containing untruths and half-truths, which were worse than untruths. It was not possible for me to reject your request so long as I was working there as a minister with you and under your leadership. But I can no longer afford to carry this load of false pretensions and untruth on my conscience. And I've decided to offer my resignation as your minister, excuse me, which I am hereby placing in your hand and which I hope you will accept without delay. You are, of course, at your liberty to dispense with that office or dispose of it in such a manner as may suit adequately and effectively the objectives of your Islamic State. You can have your Islamic State. Yours sincerely, Joginder Nath Mandal, 8th October 1950. Wow. Okay, this was a live reading. There is so much to read about this artificial country's history and all the chauvinistic Pakistanis thumping their chests. They don't even read their own history. It's not much, my dear. The first 10 years alone. I have pasted the link of this in the description. Read it.